What's up, grown folk? It is episode 20. Oh my gosh, it is 2024. First episode. Well, not really the first episode of the year. I did a recap episode that just dropped this past Friday. So definitely check that out. Recapping all of the episodes, the clips that I loved for the 2023 episodes. Definitely check that out. But I'm super excited to come into the new year, and I have a guest on the podcast today. Super excited about that. So we have Clee Ann here. What's going on?
Hey, it's Clee. I am good. Happy to be here on this beautiful morning. Well, it's actually rainy out, but
yeah.
Still a good
day. Raining over here
too. I'm here with you.
Yes. And we got a lot of shit to talk. A lot of grown convo to have, for sure.
Yes, I miss our convos.
So before we get into, you know, anything, let's just do a quick catch up, because we actually used to work together. You know, we had a client
that volunteered together.
Okay, yeah, volunteered together. Because there was a business that we saw the vision for this business, we saw the potential, and we offered our services, you know, with the thought of
free trial.
Right, with the thought of like, hey, we see where it's going, we are coming in, you know, in the trenches with you to get it up, you know, to take it to a next level. But you know, we definitely worked together and everything, and now fast forward, I saw that you had invited me to join this travel group. And I went in on the group and I looked and everything. So what you got going on with the travel stuff?
Hey, so I've actually worked with several travel groups and branched out into realizing that I don't necessarily want to run a travel group. That's never been my prerogative. Even with working with the last group, my vision has always been to help, to make a difference, to watch things grow, to come in from the logistics and coordinating and execution side. You know, just to help things be pristine, especially with Black business. We want the reputation to stand for itself. We want things to look in decency and in order. So since gaining 2 years of experience from that last group and seeing it go from not having an professional email to not having a website to not having any of those things of standard, but having such a great customer base and people who love each other and love traveling with each other, that it's grown tremendously. And I believe that it's still growing. You know, I have no, I wish nothing but the best for them as they continue to grow professionally. But so since no longer working with that group, I've had the opportunity to work with High Life Travel, which is an amazing new group. They actually sold out their first trip, which is a cabin trip in Gatlinburg. Yes. And then we have Jamaica coming up. Yeah. So Jamaica is going to be in July, and it launched yesterday. I just feel like, you know, the vibes are good, the professionalism, the desire to really bring amazing experiences to the people, authenticity. You know, if we put a resort out there, that's the resort we're going to. We're not, you know, putting any false hope out there.
We're over delivered.
So, no, in general, like I see that a lot across the board.
Okay.
You so silly. But if the shoe fits, you must acquit, right?
Not if the shoe fits, you got to acquit. If the shoe fit, baby, you're guilty.
You're guilty.
Right.
I'm trying to be my best behavior, girl.
No, listen. She worked. Ooh, I'm glad we rescheduled. I forgot they play on the Saturday. They play 3 Saturdays this season. So this is one of the Saturdays they play, and it's against our rival, the Baltimore Ravens. So I was like, ooh, yes, I'm glad she rescheduled this thing for 11. You know, it's early in the morning. We ain't taking no shots or nothing. But, you know, usually, you know, once I get into my, like, guest bag and whenever I have my whole space, I want it to be a whole thing. We're going to be drinking, having a good time, you know, all of that. So I'm super excited about getting that together. But We could we could take some shots virtually too, but it's 11 o'clock in the morning.
Okay. I just got a few more updates. Let me see. Yeah, so I'm excited. I've been working with several groups. So I've worked on like a Charlotte trip, and I put together a family reunion cruise for someone. Where I am right now is I just want to work with all different types of groups and families, and whether it's a travel group or whatever. Like, I love putting things together. I love coordinating. I love logistics. Mm-hmm. And that's actually just my calling, and realizing that I can do that and I don't have to be tied to one particular group, and that people I work with understand, like, you can work with anybody who you want to work with. That does not threaten me. That does not interfere with my business.
Because there's money to be made out here. Yeah,
exactly. So I honestly appreciate working with High Life Travel, because I haven't been put on like, okay, if you're doing this, you only here with me. I'm able to branch out and do what I need to, as well as, like, I had another business called CGF Travel. And we also worked with a lot of other groups, and that's like still in its beginning stages and just trying to understand what direction it wants to go. And then just my travel business by itself, which is working with the travel agency and just building up from there. So it's just so many doors that's been opening that I'm grateful. And then lastly, my women's retreat. It's called Flourishing From Within. That is in Belize this May, from May 2nd to May 7th. And it's really, it's about women just coming out their shell, being their most authentic self. And, you know, this is the year authenticity, jumping out and just being you, like being unafraid. And I think that through these experiences and through my experience with the last travel group, and just being such a people pleaser in my earlier years, that I've really found my voice. Because at a certain point, it's like, Clean, how much more are you going to take if this is not aligning, you know, with you and who you are and what you stand for? So I just appreciate the opportunity to, like, really step out of that shadow of myself and grow into who I am, because I just turned 30, you know? So it's like, okay, like, this is a different level of growth and
listen, I'm 30, baby.
Realization. And everybody can't get you. Everybody can't get you, and that's okay. So yeah, nothing but peace, love, and hair grease, girl.
So let us know a little bit more about the retreat. Like, for those, is it, first of all, are there still spots available for the retreat? Yes, are you guys sold out?
We are halfway sold out. We have 3 more spots. Well, no, 5 more spots left. And because we wanted to keep it a small, intimate gathering for women.
Gotcha.
We have the whole retreat space booked out, and we still have openings if people would like to book. I would love to have more women. It's just opportunity to come. We have, like, the Mayan healing ceremony. We have, you know, a release ceremony where we either burn or, like, you know, just write out the things, and you kind of, like, just release it and just break out of those bad habits.
Yeah.
We have...
I saw y'all had a special guest, like a guest speaker.
Yes. So we have Miss Manana, and she is amazing. She used to work with Dr. Sebi. Like, this woman's resume is out of this world, just all the things she's done in her life. And she just talks about health and the things that we put into our bodies, and just, you know, how we could combat so many things. Like, we don't have to deal with illnesses or fibroids or everything that's kind of attacking our bodies, especially as Black women, that we can combat that through the things we're consuming and putting into our bodies and putting into our psyche. So I'm really excited to have her there, and just all the different workshops, like doing our vision boards, and just by then it'll be halfway through the year. So it's like, if you already did one, like, are you following up with that? What are you achieving? Like, what else do you want to put energy into?
What's the vision for the remainder of the year? Yeah, I like that.
Yeah. So really just putting so much sisterhood and energy. I wanted to be a space where women could come, they could release, they can, you know, just be their most unapologetic self. And it's not a heavy media thing, so they're not gonna have, like, cameras in their face, like, you know. It's very private, very intimate.
I like that. I like that. That's cool. So I definitely, you know,
give you a link.
Yes, definitely give me the link. I'll put it in this episode description, and I definitely, you know, want to talk to you more, because off of the podcast, about, you know, all of the travel stuff that you're doing, because I feel like you're doing that. I got this luxury business.
Yeah.
You know, something like, you know,
we'll talk more about it.
And it's like, oh, you got
your business and you collaborate. You know, I'm all about that. So
right, you consulting all the travel groups, girl. I need to be plug me in.
I still have your journal, girl. I still have your journal. Remember you published your journal a bit back, and I
ordered
it on Amazon, and you were actually one of the people who taught me about Amazon publishing. So I put a few things out on there, and it's like, wow,
I love it.
Thank you so much. So,
See, I love that. You know what? And whenever I hear people tell me things like that, it just, because I haven't published any like journals, anything lately. But when I hear people like, yeah, girl, I got your book, or, you know, I got your journal, I'm like, oh. It gets me excited, because it's like, I got to keep doing what I'm doing, you know, keep putting stuff out there, keep putting your content out there. But yeah, definitely send me the link so I can put the link to the retreat into the description. But I think that's enough catching up. Let's go ahead and move on to our low vibrational shit. So this is a segment of the podcast where, you know, we just want to talk about some of the low vibrational shit that has been going on lately.
Y'all deserve better than that. That's low vibrational.
Or I actually have a topic that I want to talk about with you, but I know that you have mentioned something about, you know, Cat Williams. You said you saw the interview with Shannon Sharp.
And he hit the ground running, jumping, and stumping, like when they say.
Listen, let me tell you. Shannon said, "What up, Cat?" My boy said, "Look, I got to get it off my chest." He didn't even say hello. He just went in. I said, damn.
He did, yes.
Oh, he was no time.
I loved it. I loved every second of it. He talked about the reckoning,
Yes, that's what you said. You said the reckoning. Yeah. He did mention it's coming. Yeah. When it's done in the dark, it's coming to the light, right? So, and he ain't hold back. Like, he said people's names. He let it, like, I got to set the record straight.
What did he have to be scared of, you know?
Right, because he's like, I'm living in my truth. Y'all, I can't he said, I cannot allow liars to rewrite history with their lies. And I was like, ooh, that's powerful. We definitely got to check, you got to check motherfuckers whenever they trying to lie your name or play in your face. You definitely got to check them. And this is the year for that. 2024, absolutely. 2+2+4, equal 8.
Yeah.
For new beginnings. Yeah. Okay.
This is year 8.
Yeah.
Really heavy in it. Yeah.
Heavy in it. Come on now. So I wanted to usually when I do the low vibrational segment, I'm usually, you know, oh, I seen, you know, this on Instagram, or this is what's going on in the media. You know, it's like pop culture stuff. But I wanted to actually have a conversation with you as somebody who, you said you just turned 30, right?
Yeah.
So, and you don't have any kids.
I do not.
So, do you ever feel the pressure of being in your 30s from friends and family, or even yourself, to have, like, children? Because I know whenever I was, like, in my late 20s, like, 26, 27, 28, I didn't have my son until I was 30, but whenever I was in my late 20s, I know people started like side-eyeing me and like, you ain't got no kids? Well, what's going on with you? Are you gay? You know, like, it was like, when in my early 20s, people were like, oh, good for you. You know, you don't got kids. That's good. But then once I got in my late 20s, they're like, what's happening, girl? Like, what's going on? So for you, do you feel those pressures from people because you are in your 30s and you don't have any children?
Yeah, I think the funny thing, like, with me is I feel that most people, like, family, friends, men, women, they assume that I don't want any because of my lifestyle, and I'm always gone, I'm always traveling, I'm always this, and, you know, I'm not public about any of my relationship things on social media. I just post silly stuff on Facebook, so you're not going to see who I'm with or who I'm dating or, you know, who has my attention. Like, she just worried about herself. She ain't trying to have no kids. She ain't trying to do this, but, you know, when the time comes, it's going to happen. I do want 2 to 3 children, but definitely after marriage, I hope to do things right. I'm not always the most responsible, but I feel like God got me, you know, because it's just I call it prayer control, you know.
Yeah,
You just
prayer
gotta
control. I
pray
like
the
that.
sperm away. So
Pray the sperm away is crazy. Lord, listen, I come to you humbly. Listen, Lord, I come to you humbly. I know that man shot
Listen.
the club up last night, but please,
Anyway,
I'm praying the sperm away.
now God, I know, like you know, like we know that this is not the time.
You know my heart, Lord. You know my heart. You know my situation. Please. That is too funny. Oh my gosh. So do you like run into like your family members, maybe at family functions, like, girl, when you gonna have a child? Do you get that?
You know, it's just like I feel like everyone's proud of me because everyone else they had children when they were in their late teens or early 20s, and just the experience has been different. I was the first one, well, the only one out of my biological family to move out of my hometown. So like every time I'm doing something, they're just like, "Oh my gosh, we're so proud of you." And they're super sweet just because everything that I'm doing is so foreign and it's not like, you know, what we grew up with. Now I have my other siblings, they're starting to travel more, and my second oldest sister, she had never been on a trip and she went on a cruise with me for my birthday, and like she was just like a big kid. Like I felt like the big sister and mom. She's like, "Oh my gosh, this water is so blue. I've never seen that." And you know, just the whole experience. And it was like the highlight of my year because we never spent time together as adults. Like that was kind of like really me getting to know my sister because I've been away from home for 10 years, which is actually over 10 years, which is my whole adult life. I haven't lived in Rochester since I was 17. So, you know, it's like, oh, we see each other on Facebook, we talk a little, but to really like have days together and like, oh my
Right,
gosh,
like kicking
I like
it
you as a
heavy.
person. You're not like just my big sister. Like we friends. Hey, girl.
Right. Oh, that's cute. I love that for
They
y'all.
don't really pressure me. I think when I'm ready and I'm in that space, like they're all going to be really happy, but probably more so surprised because I don't think I give like mom vibes unless like people like really know me. So, yeah, it's going to happen though. But I
Need some
want the
water.
soft life mom. Yeah, you could. I'm going to be the soft life mom.
Yes, listen, because let me tell you something. I am a person who I'm over here like, don't have kids. You ain't got my girl good. Don't have kids. I'm that person. I think it's because of my experience, because you know, I'm a single mother. I had my son. I went through my pregnancy by myself. I'm raising him by myself. So it's like it's not a soft life, okay? It's definitely not soft right now. I'm constantly in my masculine energy. And so that's why I'm kind of like, but I think if it was a little different, you know, if I was with a person that I loved and we were together and we did this thing together and it was just like a loving situation, then it probably would be different. I'd probably be like, oh yeah, I want to have another one, maybe, who knows? But you know, because it is a little hard being a single parent, just being a single parent is very, very, you know, a hard thing. So you want to do it and you want it to be soft, you know, you're in your soft life where you are fa financially able, because these kids are expensive, you
Are
know,
you
too.
dating?
Oh girl,
Or like
listen, I
open
talk
to
about that.
dating?
I talk about this on this podcast all the time. My dating life is trash. It's trash. Girl, listen, one of the recaps on the last episode was of a guy that I was talking to. We're getting to know each other or whatever, and you know, we start talking about like sex and stuff, and I tell guys like, hey, you're not touching me unless you have been tested. First of all, you got to be vetted, and then you know, you got to be tested. And so this mug sends me Google test result, negative STD. Like literally all he did was type into Google negative STD results, and the first picture that popped up, he screenshot it to me, thinking I'm just a dummy and I'm just gonna be like, oh, okay, cool. No, I googled negative STD results in the same picture with the exact verbatim wording, and I said, bro, you just googled that. And he was like, yeah.
Wow. I
It's
literally
hard
just
out
saw a
here.
Facebook post. about that, and they were saying like how a lot of men, this guy, he said he went to the clinic to get tested. He go every 3 to 6 months, and he said every time he's the only black man in the clinic. Like, he was like, these engines don't get tested, and he was like, that's why I don't mess with nobody's wives or baby mamas. Granted, he shouldn't anyways, but he was like, that's the main reason, because y'all not out here getting
tested. They're not getting tested, but a lot of women aren't requiring the men to get tested either.
And these things lie dormant, so it's like, just because you don't have symptoms don't mean that you do not have symptoms. You need to protect yourself. Yes. And people are out here fearless, like, they just meet someone and they try, like, to put their things in them, and women obviously are allowing them. It's not a one-way street. If it's happening, it's both sides, with the exception of assault, which is, you know, not okay. But I just really hope that's something that changes in the culture. And plus, you know, they overturned Roe versus Wade, so like all these places, it's not legal everywhere. So
for you to get, exactly. For
but
you
that's
to
population do. Control, so we know
about exactly. That. Come on out.
You know, they don't want us to be the majority, but we already are, honey.
And listen, and this is a whole nother discussion, but
you know, we got y'all
grandchildren is dating us black folk, so y'all get, it's a lot of mixed babies going around here, so, but that's a whole nother thing. Back to the topic though that I was talking about, when it comes to, like, you know, just you being in, you know, you're new to the 30s crew, welcome. And you don't have any children. For me, I feel like I do have friends who don't have children, and they are in their 30s, and they do get the side eyes and the questions at the family functions and things. And I just wish that people would stop doing that, because you don't know what the person's situation is. Maybe they don't want children.
Infertility.
That part. And I don't want to be discussing that with you while I'm trying to eat my goddamn hot dog at the cookout. Like, why you got no kids? Because I can't have them. Cousin, Bobby, leave me alone. Like, I wish people would stop, you know, stop with that. Like, just kind of be mindful of that. Like, might be an insensitive question to ask. If they're not talking about it, let me not bring it up, because you never know.
People feel entitled to personal information because of the age of social media. People feel like they need to know everything, and it's okay for them to ask. Like, even the way we pry into celebrity lives, it's like we forget they're people. So that's just the age of social media. They don't care about your privacy. Family, friends, people you don't know.
Like, it's the entitlement and the audacity for me. So let's move on and give somebody some flowers. Do you have anybody that you want to give flowers? I usually do. I was telling you off camera that, you know, I usually do this segment where I like to give somebody their flowers for, like, just business moves or just being a dope-ass person in general. So do you have anybody that you want to shout out, give some flowers to?
Yes. Well, for starters, I would love to give you your flowers, girl, just because you've been standing on business before it was even a thing, honey. Like, and I'm going to give you that 200%. Just because like, you have your boundaries, you know what you will and what you won't, and you stick to that. And even, and, you know, our experience working together is like, you know, this is what I'm willing to give, and then this is where I can no longer give. And you stood on it. You didn't uno reverse. You didn't spin the block. You said, this is what it is. Like, I love y'all. I wish y'all the best. This has been a good experience. But if I can't get my needs met as a single mother, and knowing that I'm someone who has a business and I know what I give, I can't pour into something that's not pouring into me. And honestly, I respect that. And
thank you.
Though it took me 2 years later, I took from that, and it's like, you know, you're right. And it's at a certain point, you do have to set those boundaries. And I just love that you've been able to do that. And I've seen you have several businesses. I know you're in a storefront. You know, I love the way that you parent, because I watch a lot of your posts about your son.
Thank you.
And, just like, you know, the gentle parenting, and I see you breaking generational curses, and just the way that you're patient, and you're, you know, you're the fun mom. And I really watch how you show up, because you talk about you're at his school functions, and I'm like, I don't remember my parents being at my stuff. So, like, I just, even if you feel like you're alone or you're doing it by yourself, like, you're doing an amazing freaking job. And I just want to let you know, friend. I just want to let you know that I see you. I see you. I see you. So, yes, that is your flowers.
Thank you. I really appreciate that. You really about to have me on this podcast crying because, you know, just for you to say, like, you know, you're breaking the generational curses. I see you, you know, when you post and you talk about you go to your son's function. I'm like, oh, she's seen. You know, I'm talking about going to the gym. So I definitely appreciate that. Thank you so much for that. That makes me feel so great. Anybody else that you want to give flowers to?
Yes. Oh, girl. I got her over here tearing up, but I mean it.
But no, I definitely want to give you your flowers as well, because when we first got together to, like, would you say volunteer? We first got together, we were working together. I was like, you know what? This girl, she got that business together, like the whole like website and just the business aspect of it. And even when I was leaving out of that thing, I had told y'all like, hey, we need to come together, you know, and do something together, because I feel like we got the components that we need. And I just respect you as a businesswoman, as far as like how you really, because listen, even if you weren't giving your flowers, you know, where you were at, I'm gonna give you your flowers because you really took that to the next level. Like, as far as the website, as far as like how the group is now booking the trips, the spreadsheet that we had, that you had put together for like the rooms and all that stuff takes work, and it took time out of what you were, you know, doing. Like, we're businesswomen. We have businesses, and we did volunteer our services for free
for limited time only.
Yeah, you know,
the circumstances for limited time. So
once we felt like it was kind of taken away from what we are trying to accomplish and how we feed our family, then we had to like step away from it. But you did a lot, you know. And even if that wasn't told to you, and that was my main thing with leaving in the first place, it was like, hey, even if you're not gonna pay me, give me my flowers, my boy. You know, like, you ain't even if you're not gonna pay me, like, just show me some appreciation. And so, even if you weren't given, you know, shown the appreciation, I don't know. I left. I don't know what was going on.
I think in the beginning, it was definitely like, you know, I don't mind. Like, I really just want to help. I want to help. But then it's like, you know, and it's not even about like counting someone's pockets or anything like that, but it comes to being a level of respect and appreciation. And it's like, I see you doing X amount and I'm putting in X amount of time. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I'm showing up. And in the times when I didn't, it's like mental health comes first. I'm going to have to take care of myself, because if I'm putting in X amount of hours every week and I'm struggling or I'm stressing, because at the time, you know, we're in a full blown pandemic, like the pandemic, the times were hard. So it's like, I'll make sure that you are eating, your family's eating, these people signing up. Because a lot of times, you know, maybe people didn't, if the only source of payment was not a professional payment source, not everyone knows you. But and I really didn't want to get into this, but it's just like, after a certain point, it's like, if it's no longer volunteer work, because now it's like, I'm seeing the fruits of my labor, but I ain't even getting an apple.
Like you said, we ain't got to get in.
We don't got to get all. Can I get a basket of apples?
Can I just get a gift card or something? That's all I'm saying. Some lunch on you. Something. No, but I mean, we don't really have to get deep. I just wanted to give you your flowers for just being the person that you are, as far as when it comes down to like business and everything. And again, now we're here, and there's another opportunity for maybe us to, you know, collaborate on some things. And so I really appreciate the fact that I can come back around and be like, because I'm not, oh, you know what? Now that I'm thinking about it, I was talking to the other person that we were working with that group, the other girl. I ain't saying no names. I'm not name drop. I don't name drop or anything, but the other person that we were working with. And I was telling her, you know, when I was starting my podcast, I said, you know what, I might reach out to Clee, because I might need her to manage some things, you know.
And, you know, that was actually a heartbreak for me, that situation, particularly with that person, because I just absolutely adored them, look up to them, and there was literally nothing but love in that situation, the way that I spoke of them and everything. I literally never had anything bad to say, and it was just certain experiences with that where it's like, Wow. Like it's definitely not mutual. And it's like when you hold someone to such a hard I mean such a high regard, and they like disappoint you on more than one occasion. Like that was a literal heartbreak for me, because the man, he's gonna be who he is, and he's always been that person. Like you don't really get surprised. But when it's someone you like, that's my love, that's my sister, like we ride, like even if we don't agree on everything, like this is someone I love and respect, and you see like they like F you and don't try to have an understanding, like that was a literal heartbreak for me. But life goes on, and it was another situation where I'm like, my mom always said, everybody ain't your friend, everybody ain't your friend. So when people pick, I'm always gonna go with what's right in my heart, and I'm not gonna condone, regardless. If you my friend, I'm gonna tell you wrong. So I'm not ever gonna condone anything that's not right, and I'm not gonna allow people to treat somebody else any kind of way. And it doesn't mean I'm not loyal to you, that I don't love you. But if you wrong, I'm gonna tell you you're wrong again. So
and I see that touch,
those ties are severed, but
And I see that really touched your heart. I can tell, I can hear it
did, because voice. Like I didn't see that coming, but it is what it is.
Listen, look. Let's move off of that topic, because
too much airtime.
we don't want to spend all of our segment. Again, like I said, I just want to give you your flowers. You're a dope individual, and I see you post them on Facebook, and it's funny.
Oh my god, girl, that is a whole thing. That's me flourishing.
I love it.
So many people don't know that, so that's why it's funny, because with like the things that I post now, I hadn't posted on Facebook in like 10 years because like I mostly used Instagram, and like that was a source of discomfort for me, because it's like, oh my gosh, I got people from church on Facebook, and I got old teachers on Facebook, my elders are on Facebook, and it was like just having not been in Rochester and just having a disconnect with my second family, because I was like adopted into another family, and it was just like a disconnect of communication over years, and that was its own situation that I had to grow and heal from, that I just didn't feel comfortable speaking online or speak my truth, or because people are always wondering, oh, what happened to so-and-so, or what happened, because social media is being your business media. So that's why I don't say nothing real, and like people don't know that talk I'm about like, it. Silly and I'm playful and all those things. So now when I post, I'm like, I'm 30 years old. Like, who finna check me? Like, I ain't about to get grounded.
Listen, come on, let's talk about it. Who about to check me? So, because I'm grown, I pay my own bills. Who's about to do that?
And y'all ain't carried myself since unless I was you, little, so.
Unless you feeding, fucking, or financing me. And even if you fucking feed me, you still ain't gonna check me. Boo, sorry. I'm sorry.
Exactly. And speaking of, I post what I want. I'm silly. And
I love that. I love it. I be seeing posts from Clee. I be like, this girl. And then what makes it funny is I'm like, she's so organized, because all of her posts are scheduled.
But the other reason for that though is so I don't chicken out and pressing the post button, because I'm like really trying to have that voice, and I'm used to being like very like pristine in a way, but I'm like, I want to be silly too. So sometimes if it's something more risky, I'm gonna schedule it, and I'm not even gonna look at when it's gonna post. So when it posts, I'm just as surprised as everybody else, because I don't remember writing it, because you could post up out to 30 days, but I'm like, if I just press it right away, I'm worried about, oh my gosh, who saw it, what do you think, is this too much, I gotta delete it. So it's my anxiety, because it's like, no, I want to post this because I think it's funny. It's not hurting nobody, but I don't want to chicken out, because if I post it within the time, I'm like, oh my gosh, maybe I should do that. I shouldn't post that. Blah, blah, blah. And it's not even anything bad. It's just my sillier side. So that's honestly why I schedule them, or it'd be like a random ass time in the middle of the night, because I'm such a night owl that I'm like, I'm not about to post this because I just told this dude I was going to sleep that I'm not going to post this at 3 a.m. Like, I thought you said you was going to bed at 12.
That is too funny. I love that. Like, I love that for you. Like, I love that you are stepping out of your comfort zone and just, doing something that and showing a different part of your personality. So that's awesome. And I want to give you your flowers for that. So let's move on to, it gets spicy here at Rated M. And I know, Clee, you are more of a reserved, but We do have a pussy power segment, and pussy is a word that I love.
Okay.
It's very powerful. Yes, come on. This pussy powerful. So, in this pussy power segment, we're not gonna get too spicy, but I do want to talk about. I know that you wanted to touch on keeping relationships private versus secret. So, do you think that there is a difference between keeping a relationship private versus keeping it secret?
Yes, there's absolutely a difference. In particular, like, I think privacy is important in a sense of, like, maybe you're not posting your person all the time, or, like, you know, people don't necessarily know the ins and outs of what's going on in your personal mm-hmm. and relationship life. But if you are with someone and you are exclusive, then it should be known that you are in a relationship, that it is exclusive and you're not entertaining other people. So I think that's private. But mm-hmm. secret is like no face, no case, no name, no existence. You over here and, you know, what happens outside of this is whatever. I feel like something secret is just, it's a disrespect to both people in the interaction, especially if they want to have a future together. So I think there's a fine line between the two.
Have you ever been anybody's secret, or have you ever kept somebody's secret?
I'm actually trying to think. I realize I haven't had that many relationships, mm-hmm. Like actual like relationships. Cause my first relationship out of college, like that was 6 years long, and then you know, ouch. Then the next one, I dated like a narcissistic pastor, and that was a whole experience. Like.
Narcissistic pastor.
You know what? I guess maybe that was a secret because he was a little bit older and like he wasn't with anyone, but he was like going through a divorce. But it was just like so much craziness, and I had never encountered anything like that in my mm-hmm. life, so that was full of lessons. But I would say like maybe in the beginning of that, it was like a secret because one, I didn't want to be in like no drama or anything as they're going through their process. And it didn't even start as a situation where it's like, oh, I want to be with you on a date. You was like, oh, this person mm-hmm. is nice. They showed up for me. Like, and in my head, you think of past, you think of good people. You like, oh, that's the man of God. And I'm like, damn, that's a man of hell. Like, that's a facade. like, please take your spirit. Like, this
right.
Satan's house.
Even the devil, no church line. So,
that part. So that was my first wolf in sheep's clothing experience, and it was a lot of lessons there. But I guess I would say that it started off as like a secretive thing maybe, but then I'm like, it's not really like people in my life didn't know, or certain people in his life didn't know, but it was just like I wasn't about to post them on Facebook or nothing
yeah
like that. So mm-hmm. or even mention it.
But, and I'm like you, like I haven't had a lot of relationships, like serious relationship. I had a lot of situationships. And I'm trying to think in the situationships. There's one in particular kind of similar to what you just talked about, where the last time that the person was in my life, he was kind of going through like the divorce. He was separated. Mm-hmm. They were living separately and everything, but he just had so much fucking baggage, like separated. Then you find out you got a new baby mama, cause you got a new baby on the way. There's so much stuff. And it was like, I'm a private person as it is. So it's like, we're being private, but then at the same time, I'm looking back and I'm like, but were you trying to keep it a secret? I don't know. Was I trying to keep it a secret? Probably, because I'm probably more embarrassed about just like, girl, you put up with that bullshit. Mm-hmm. But most of like the situations or like anybody that I'm involved with, it is kind of like private. When I like find my man,
yeah.
Then I'm going to let it be known, but it's still going to be on a private thing. Like, you're not going to be seeing me posting a whole bunch of, like, what we got going on and things like that. You might, you know, catch a picture or so here and there on a trip or something like that. Right. But I think I'm just a private person in general. I post what I want y'all to know, and that's just what it is. So, for me, as far as, like, keeping relationships private, I feel like that's a good thing. Like, everybody don't need to be in your business. Look at all these celebrity couples. Exactly. It's like they can't do nothing. Like, I just feel so bad for like Sierra, because it's like, she has a beautiful, from what we are have been shown, she has a beautiful marriage and everything. And it's like, boy, don't let one thing happen, which in relationships, shit do, like, shit happen, you know, things do happen, right. But don't let one little thing happen in the relationship, that shit's gonna be blown up to the next level, especially because of the pedestal that we put on them, you know, put them on, and it's like, that's why, like, keeping your shit private is, you know, it might be good for your mental.
That part. Yeah, I mean, we see Holly Bailey, she keeping her stuff private and all the speculations about whether she had a kid. And isn't that so crazy, the world we live in? Like, people are so focused on her uterus and her life and all this. And it's like, if she wants to tell us, if it happened, then it'll happen. But people are literally zooming in every picture, like, doing their research and trying to figure out, like, is she or is she not? But it's like, what does this have to do with your life and your bills? Like,
and I'm not even going to lie to you. The people that are like that, they got me like that. Like, nah, I don't be zooming in, but they got me. Y'all got me like that. Like, now I see everybody's like, oh, she pregnant. So now every time I look at her, I be looking like, she do got that. Her neck looking a little, I don't know. And then I'm just like, so you, are you trolling us or what's going on? Because you know,
stepping out. It's just like celebrity life. Like,
yeah, I probably would troll too. Like, I was about to have every big outfit I could find, put it on me, and then it's like,
that's gonna be me.
After a certain amount of time, there was a video where they were like, I think they were making cookies or something, and then she's like, she got the camera on her, she gets up, you can see her flat stomach and stuff. I said, y'all better go ahead and get
like,
y'all.
She done already had the baby. I'm like, y'all don't even know the timing. Like, we don't know. Has it even been 9 months? Like, did the thing bake? Like, we don't know.
But I do appreciate her keeping her, you know, keeping all of that private. Even if she did have a baby, you know, it's nobody's business, you know. And I like, when I do see people that, you know, keep their relationship private, give y'all what they want to give you and keep it private, because people are weird. Like you said, why are you zooming in? Why are you doing all this? Like, why are you really looking at your calendar like, they got together this time, and I remember they posted this one date night, that's probably when they got pregnant. Like, you doing too much. And so for me, I feel like that's the reason why I would want to keep my relationship private. Now, secret, It's a lot of married men out here cheating.
Oh, they want a happy relationship, still be stepping out. And that's something that really confuses me, because it's not like, you know, they say like sometimes people cheat because they're not happy or they're not getting something at home. But sometimes everything is okay, but they just are curious or whatever the case is. And people still step out and do stuff. And like at the end of the day, it's not like they don't want their person, because I'm not even going to gender specific it, because it's on both sides at times. That you just really never know. And I just pray that whenever I am with someone and I have my forever person, that they don't have me looking crazy and they don't have no one out here thinking they got something on me, because my person decides like, oh, I'm bored or I'm horny or whatever for these 2 seconds, but I ain't going nowhere. You don't have me out here looking crazy. Like,
you know what I think about that? I think that people just kind of need to live in their truth about their how they view relationships, because a lot of people, they say monogamy, but it's like, really, is that really what you want to do? Do you really want to be in a monogamous relationship? Because I don't think that it is, and it's okay. Like, we're now living in times where, you know, we're seeing more of the poly side of things, you know, people who are ethically non-monogamous or, you know, polygamous, whatever, you know, like, you're seeing all the different dynamics of relationships, and you don't have to put yourself in the monogamy box if that's not what you want to be, and you just have to be honest with yourself so that you can be honest with your person or persons. And, you know, hey, I do want to be with you, like, on an exclusive level. However, you know, I may have, you know, I might have a vibe with somebody else as well, and is that okay? And if it's not, you're not my person, I got to keep it pushing, you know? And like, for me, I had to learn that too. I'm like, you know what? The monogamy thing is cool and everything, but I don't want to put myself in that box, honestly. you know, and I just feel like people just need to be more honest about it and have those conversations and communicate that better, and then that way you don't have these problems where you're married but you got your side chick, she a secret and all that. Right. Just be honest. Hey, listen, I want to marry you, but I want to have my side bitches too. Okay, like just
and again, give the person the right to decide if
that's give them the right to decide. Yes, yeah. And you'll be surprised how many people would be like, "Oh, okay, I'm cool with that." That's
to take what you dishing out because it's what I said. Yeah, I'm like, okay, well, I'm gonna have my dudes too, and they're like, "No, you
right have that part."
That part, not so can we both do it? Like,
yeah,
no,
and okay, you gotta find your person that's cool with that.
Figure that out in therapy, honey.
Yeah,
that's not what you want to do. There, and shout out to therapy. Okay, I think everyone
very needed
to go, whether it's maintenance or whatever, at some point in your life. Like, I will always advocate for mental health, and that's my other page, Mindically, is definitely for advocating for mental health. So.
Okay.
I stand on that because I've had to, and even with like when we were working, like I had to take time for mental health or whatever. Like I realized that's something that I need, and if I get overwhelmed, I worked on handling that differently. So typically, I don't know how long we've been on friends on social media. Sorry, I'm off topic a little bit, but
fine.
I would disappear from social media for like months at a time, like deactivate everything, and I'm just gone. And I haven't done that in over a year, which is a big deal for me.
Big deal.
One, I miss that time, but it's like I'm so involved in so many things right now that I can't just cut off my accounts. But it's just like now I had to find another way to kind of step away and recharge. So it's like, just log out. And we have to not be so addicted to these things. So I've noticed like when I logged out of Facebook, I would keep clicking the app because my brain forgets that I logged out. And I'm not on here. I probably did that like 15 times in a day. And it's like, you gotta break those habits and like
we
be
are
in
addicted.
The moment, be in real life too. Because
it's important.
That's not real life. Yes.
You know what, Clee? I love, you know, that you are talking about this grown conversation here. You know, you gotta go to therapy and it kind of segues into our grown convo for the day, for this episode. Bitch, we motherfucking grown. Which is when it comes to dating, we're gonna stay on the dating aspect of it. When it comes to dating, dating with emotional intelligence and communication, what are your thoughts on that? Like, how important is it for you to date somebody who exudes those things?
Okay. It is very important. And like, I have some really amazing male friends at this point, and we get to have a lot of these conversations candidly. And, one of my friends, we're talking about like a girl brain versus like man brain.
Uh-huh.
And a lot of times we literally, it's like we're really from Venus and they're from Mars, because we, the same situation, we will see it completely differently. And then when we say what our thoughts are out loud, instead of just reacting on things and the other person doesn't know what you thought about it or how you feel, but you're just pissed off, when you finally get a chance to say it out loud to that person and actually communicate, because that's a big part of emotional intelligence, you're like, oh my gosh, like I didn't think of it that way. Now I see why you did that. And it's like, oh, okay, that makes sense. And you resolve things a lot quicker. So I think emotional intelligence is a big part of like understanding and conflict resolution and really just getting to the root of things so that we can grow together in this relationship. Because before this, like I would say I would definitely be like, I got pissed off at this guy I was dating. I really liked him. We didn't have any issues. We had like one major fight and he was like rushing me to talk because I'm someone who needs time to process because I'm not, words are extremely important to me. So I'm really not going to try to say something that I can't take back. Like, that is a trigger for me. So I really just like to take my time and think through things instead of just reacting. And it's fair to give ourselves that time. But at a point in our relationship, we're like, oh, well, you know, we're not going to go to bed mad. But I'm like, you've been pissing me off all day. It's nighttime. I'm still mad, baby. Like, I need time.
Let me figure this out. Because I'm going to say something you ain't going to like. Then you're going to be real mad.
And like, you know, we didn't give each other that time. And then I felt like he was like, okay, well, you need to make a decision. I'm like, all right, well, I am out of here. Like, this is over. And the next day after that, I felt bad because I'm like, you know, I didn't want to end the relationship. Like, I really loved this person and cared about them. And it's like, well, had we actually communicated and given each other that time and space to work through it, then who knows, like, what would have happened in that situation, even if it would have ultimately ended still. So, yeah, while dating, we definitely have to open that space to have, like, real conversations and, like, have substance beyond sex and, like, have other things in common, but also have lives outside of each other. Because I think that was my first relationship where it's like, oh, you still do all this stuff. Like, I'm not coming with you. You don't want me to come? Like, and I haven't.
Yeah, I was a whole person before you, baby. Like, I had my
and,
thing
you know,
before
that's
you.
So simple. But I think in my 6-year relationship, we did everything together because we just had that time. So it was just, we were used to it. So just definitely, like, those different dynamics. Or having dated people who are somewhat, like, controlling. They're like, where are you going? What you doing? I'm coming, type of thing. Yeah. Like, I talked to someone from high school yesterday, and they've been trying to, like, date me. And I'm like, I don't know. I don't even think I'm what you want, honey, because, like, he's super traditional. And he's like, oh, well, you're not going somewhere if I'm not going to be there. And I'm like, you know, I'm a whole, like, I work in aviation. I'm gone, like,
right,
2 times a week. But also, I like to travel, and I work with travel groups. So we ain't doing everything together. I need my space.
Right.
So, just you got to really learn somebody, and that's part of the emotional aspect. Like, you got to get who you're dating, because if you just date me for what you see on the surface, and then you get to know me, and you try to change the things that attracted you to me in the first place, like, that's not going to work.
For me, I feel like there's just some skill sets that, like, skill sets and character traits that you just, in my opinion, you just have to have when it comes to dating and, you know, having the emotional intelligence. So self-awareness, because if you don't know yourself, how you going, you know what I'm saying? Like, it just starts with knowing yourself. You have to know what your triggers are. You got to know, like, what you are willing to put up with, what you're not willing to put up with. If you don't know that stuff, what are you dating for? What are your strengths? What are your weaknesses? Like, you know, hey, I need to work on being more of an empathetic person. I need to work on listening better, you know. So those things are important. That self-awareness is important.
What's your apology language?
You have to know that. What is my conflict? Yeah. I talked about that on the episode. What's your conflict resolution language? Yeah. What is that?
Did you see the quiz?
Because everybody's
on the
different.
Language? Yeah.
Everything is different because, like you just said, in that relationship that you were in, he wanted to talk now. And you were like, I don't want to talk right now. You know, so you have to know that about each other. You have to communicate those things with the person that you're dealing with. Because if I'm the type of person, and I'm like you, where it's like, give me a minute. Because one thing about it, my cutoff game is real strong. Like, oh, you fucked up. Deuces. So for me, like, I have to work on that. And it's like, give me a minute so that I can process, make sure, am I tripping or did you got me fucked up? You know, so we have to know that about each other, because I need you to give me that grace, and I'm going to give you your grace. You know, if you're a person that I need to talk about it right now, or it's just going to eat me up, then we got to kind of find a middle ground with that. So that's important, you know, being self-aware, like you said, your conflict resolution language, being an active listener, like, not just listening, like, okay, they're talking, and then now I'm gonna talk when they get done, and I'm gonna say what I need to say. Did you hear what I said? Did you process it? Yeah, like, did you process what I said? You know, and then that comes with the empathy part too. You got to be an empathetic person. Like, I mean, that's going to build the bridge that we need to have a healthy relationship. And then other things is just the communication part, period. Like, you just, you got to be really a great communicator. I feel like those things are very, very necessary when it comes to, like, the emotional intelligence and just the healthy emotional part of dating. It's very important. Communication. Ooh.
Yeah,
that part is big.
Accountability.
Because, accountability. And I ain't gonna lie, I've been that girl where it's like, who, me? I can't do no wrong. I'm that bitch for you. Like, I'm perfect. So accountability. What? I didn't do anything wrong. You know, what are you talking about? I was definitely that girl. And I'm still, you know, I'm still working on that because I, that's a big one. I think for us women, I ain't even gonna lie, you know, because we just feel like, what? What do you mean? I'm perfect for you. But those are definitely, very important.
Those are big. Yeah, very. Just being okay if you're not someone's cup of tea, because I used to feel like I had to prove myself so much in dating. It's like, he's not seeing it. Let me show him more. Let me do more. Let me love him harder. Let me be better. Let me do this so he can see how that I am. It's like, you're enough already. You're already enough. And if someone doesn't see that or they're not feeling you, like, it is okay. Like, I think women have just as much of a hard time with rejection as men. We just show it differently. We show it by, like, working harder, and men typically show it by getting pissed off and retaliating if they feel rejected. Whereas women, like, oh, he doesn't like me. Let me work harder and show him let me that go. I'm great and he should want me. Whereas a man, fuck her.
Let me go cook some food for him and wash his clothes and clean his house. And it ain't even being reciprocated. Let me go buy him something. And it's not, I was that girl too. I ain't even gonna lie. I was definitely that girl. I'm like, boy, all the things. And then here's what we say when the shit hits the fan. Everything that I did for you, baby.
More of what he
it wasn't being reciprocated. It was never being reciprocated. You did all these things. It wasn't being reciprocated. Take the rejection when you see it. Take the red flag when you see it. And that goes back to the self-awareness thing. You got to be like, I know what I bring to the table. You're not bringing what I need you to bring to the table. You're not matching my fly. It's not being reciprocated. So I got to keep it pushing. I got to accept the rejection. I got to accept the rejection and keep and find my, you know, go out and find my person, because you ain't it, baby. And that's just what it is. That's what it is. Yeah, all right. Definitely. So time-wise, let's move on to our dating horror story.
Hey, shawty, I want to take you on a date.
Do you have any dating? Because, listen, I get on this podcast and I talk about my dating app horror stories, because I got plenty of them, because I am on the dating apps. And I got plenty of dating app horror stories. I don't really go on dates too much, but you know, I talk about my dating app, and I've been getting listeners. They have been DMing me or emailing me with their horror stories. So, do you have a horror story, dating horror story, that you want to share with us? I would love to hear.
I feel like
a horror story.
Yeah, I feel like I either have like embarrassing or just a horror story, but I would say like maybe like when I was on the dating apps, I think like 2 years ago or so, I went on a date like with this person, and he seemed cool. Like, we FaceTimed and stuff ahead, and like I think we FaceTimed maybe 2 or 3 times ahead of time. And like, I went out and it was like, you know, I drove to like meet up. They talk a lot about what they have. Like, yeah, I have this house next door. I own this. I own that. I remember, you know, we just went out to eat. I'm thinking everything's cool, whatever. We driving around town and he stops. Like, the police know who he is. Like, he's driving in his car. Like, he's seems to be very known in the community. I'm like, okay, cool. So then, you know, I'm thinking like, okay, you know, it's a cool date. We had some good food. I get back. I think I gotta work the next day, but I'm like, you know, I don't mind hanging out, because like it felt like a cool space, whatever. I'm just talking about exes, just talking in general. But like, I go in and like, this is where I fucked up. So I go in certain situations, you ever be like, damn, I'm glad I got out of that safe and alive. So this is one of those. So like, you know, I go in, we're like hanging out, we're watching, I think he put like a movie on, but I noticed there's like cameras in the house and like certain things, and he's like, yeah, I did this, I paid for this interior decorator, you know how much this thing is, whatever. Like, according to him, multi-millionaire, whatever. And oh, also, he lied about his age, because he looked a lot younger, like a little bit, but then he had to be at least about like 10 years older than what he told me.
Wow.
Yeah, just like his mannerisms and stuff were like very old, but then also like his face. I'm like, you are not in your 30s, sir.
Mm-hmm.
Like that happened, and like we were talking, but then he started like talking about Illuminati stuff, and like it just kind of went really left. And then he was basically saying like I should have sex with him so that I can get rid of the energy of anyone I've been with before him. And like it just got very uncomfortable. And I remember I was like, yeah, no, like I'm on my side. You know, that's kind of like our default as
we
have to do this to protect ourselves. But yeah, no, I'm like on my cycle. I'm good. Like, you know, you know, just trying to be respectful, because at the end of the day, I'm like, I'm in this man's house and
this his character like this
is wrong. Like I'm small. This is a big man. Like I have to I don't wanna like aggregate the situation and not get out of here safely. And so basically I remember I was like, oh, I just gotta use the bathroom. So I go in the bathroom, use it, and I'm like ready to flush, and the toilet don't flush, and I'm like, oh my gosh, what if this man comes in here and checks, see if I really got my cycle or whatever. So I like have to open the top of the thing, and I'm like, good thing I got at least 2 cents in my brain. Like I like remember, you know how you could go on top of the thing, you pull up the pump, and you can get it to flush. So then I came out. He's like, "Oh, how did you get the toilet to flush? How did you know?" And I was like, "Oh, you know, I didn't want to leave any personal care products in your bathroom."
My girl said, "I'm like, oh, I'm taking this live to the
grave." Yes, because like it just got super uncomfortable. He started talking about all these things. So then I finally like it was like, you know, I gotta work. I really enjoy my time with you. And he's like, well, you're going to call me when you get back, right? Because we got unfinished business. I'm like, yeah, whatever, whatever. So then he calls me, like, while I'm driving home. And it's like a half an hour drive. And he's like, you're going to come back. You're going to let me know, right? Because I didn't feel sure about your answer. And I'm like, like, yeah, you know, I'll let you know. But then I was like, we were talking. I'm like, actually, you know, I don't think this is a great match. Like, you know, you were very nice, but I don't see this like going beyond this date. And he's like, you luckily someone of my caliber would even talk to you. Like, he just went in, girl. It was like the craziest experience. And like, because of who I am, like, if you notice, I really am good with like de-escalating and conflict resolution. So I felt like even though his ego was bruised or whatever, I'm like just calm, and I'm like, yeah, you know, I just don't think it's a good match, you know, I'm not ever really around, blah blah blah. And what he's like, because he was going in, and then like towards the end he called himself giving me relationship advice, like, you know, these men,
oh my god,
you know, like he went into like full uncle mode, and I'm like, you was just trying to like take my head off or not wanting to be with you, to like, you know, you really just gotta value yourself and take care of yourself. And like it just turned into a completely different conversation. I'm like, this man is Jekyll and Hyde, but also like that was a horror story, because I think of like, what if he would have been aggressive? And I'm like, this man friends with the police. Like, I could have ended up in a
trial. Yeah, girl, come on.
Because they knew him in the community. Like, I would have been good as gone.
And I'm so glad that you were able to be like, oh, I'm on my cycle. You know,
like just, you know, protect myself.
Because the fact that this man said you need to have sex with me to cleanse your energy. So you're the energy cleanser.
He really believed that. Like, he believed whatever it was that he did, because he told me, I got $1 million in this and this company and that company. And I'm not someone who's really impressed by those things. I've always been around things. I've always had my own. Like, I've always been a go-getter. But also, I'm like very chill. I'm not like the Louis bag, Gucci bag, Fendi, like whatever type of person. Like, I'm very like, I don't call it low maintenance, because I have things that I do love, and I'm a travel. I'm going to spend money on that trip, but I'm not impressed by like what you have or how you dress or designers. Like, look clean, take care of yourself, whatever, but I don't care what you have on type of thing. But he tried to impress me with all that, and it was just like a scary, uncomfortable situation. He really felt like his dick was the Messiah or something. And, like, so, like, it's going to save you from your wrongs. You will be pure again after you let me.
Yeah, that girl, that was definitely a dating horror story. I'm glad you made it out safely. And you had the right mind to, not only did I tell you to lie, my boy, but I kept it going. Oh yeah, I just didn't want any paraphernalia to be stuck in your toilet. I want you to see all that. So, oh my gosh. That is a dating horror story.
Yeah, it could have went very left. So I do think about that occasionally, and I'm like, I'm not out there on dating apps or anything anymore. But I do remember I got on, I was swiping a little bit, and I came across his profile, and I'm like, damn, I should have reported it. But all I was, like,
you should have reported that immediately. Yeah. Yeah. OMG, because dang, I don't hate to have to come across him because I'm about to tell him about it. So I'm not like, look, man, let me get up. I'm like, bruh, are you serious? You think I'm going to cleanse my energy? Get up. And then he probably would have killed me.
Like, no, for real. Like, I felt like the cameras, the setup, the everything. And
everything
like,
was
like,
weird.
The way that the locks were set on the door. You're like, I could just open the door and get out. Like, he had, like, one of those, I forget the name of that book, the Second World Order book or something.
Oh, my God. Okay.
It was very deep.
He into some underground stuff.
And I didn't even want to know more details. I was good on that. But, like, I never had that encounter again. I haven't had another situation where I'm more mindful, like, okay, trust the energy and vibes, but
definitely vetting more for sure, because we got to vet these dudes better, but it is a little hard because they do send a representative for sure, and we'd be like, oh, okay, seems cool, but
he's nice, he's cool, but
then they get you to the crib and they want to talk about their dick cleansing your energy and weird ass shit like that. But I definitely appreciate you sharing that dating horror story. And for those of you that are listening, if you do have a dating horror story that you want to share, you want me to read on the podcast, please send in your dating horror story. You can DM it to the podcast page on Instagram at Rated M Cause We MF Grown, or you can email it at ratedmcausewemfgrown@gmail.com, and I will read your horror story on one of the episodes. I will keep you anonymous, of course. Ain't no name dropping over here. So send them in, because listen, as you can see, I'm not the only one with the dating horror stories. We all can relate. We can all relate to having a dating horror story or two. So send those in and I will read it on the podcast. Now, we done talked about a lot of things. We done talked about niggas' dicks cleansing your energy. We done talked about emotional intelligence with your in relationships. We've talked about, your woman's retreat and all the things you got going on. We even talked about some low vibrational things, you know, dealing with the previous travel group that you were in. I always like to end the episode with on a positive note, with a spiritual download. So do you have any words of affirmations or a positive quote or anything that you want to leave the listeners with before we wrap this thing on up?
Calm down. Yes. These are my mantras that I typically go by, and it's,
I'm sorry, Clee. Sorry to cut you off. Before we even do that, I'm sorry. Let's just take a moment. If you are led to do it, then do it. Close your eyes and let's just inhale and exhale three times. So let's inhale again. Inhale. Exhale. And one more time. Inhale. And exhale.
Yes.
All right, give us the mantras you got.
Yes, and I actually do love breath work. They have breath work sessions in different cities, and I went to one, and you kind of get a very deep experience just from that breath work and breathing a certain way, and it feels like you may have like taken like a psychedelic or something, but you didn't take anything. It's like our
brain comes really,
like, yeah. So definitely look into that. It's very cleansing. So for me, my big one this year is I am stepping into my power. I trust this timing of my life, and I find peace through discipline.
I am stepping into my power.
I trust the timing of my life.
I trust the timing of my life.
And I find peace through discipline.
And I find peace through discipline. Ooh.
Yeah.
That part right there, because listen, discipline is going to get you that peace, because if it's just chaotic, if you don't have any discipline in your routines and the things that you do, it's just chaos. So when you buckle down and you're disciplined. Okay, here's the routine. This is how we're gonna do things. Boom, 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 boom. Those are some good ones right there, yeah. Khalid. For real. Y'all get it in your spirit. Yeah. I received that for sure. And I appreciate you for coming on the podcast and talking your shit with me. Yes, we're going to have to do this again for sure. Yes. Let the people know where they can find you if you want to be found.
You can find me on Call Her Klee or Mind of Klee. Both of those are on Instagram. I've really been trying to get into the Threads app, but for some reason, I just haven't got on there yet. Yeah, but it's like it's really hard to connect with other people on there. So I'm like, I mean, granted, I do have full blown conversations with me, but on there, you really talking to yourself.
Yeah. I feel like it's like Twitter. It is Twitter went to a whole different level. Twitter is Pornhub 2.0 now. Yes, it went to a whole nother level. So it's like the old Twitter, where it's just like you really just putting your thoughts down. You know, you just like you said, talking to yourself, and you just
It doesn't have the explore page though. Yeah,
mm-hmm. And that's a cool part. I like that. I literally just got on Threads like a couple days ago, and what I'm seeing a lot on there is people that are like, "Hey, I'm a podcast host algorithm. I'm looking for producers, you know, people to be on the, like, I'm seeing a lot of that. So I'm seeing people that are trying to like network and, hey, I'm following, you know, I'm following everybody back, follow me, and, you know, we'll do this thing, let's grow together. I'm seeing a lot of that, but I want to see a lot of just people just that are like me, like you, that are just kind of putting our thoughts, you know, and we could just kind of interact that way. Yeah. But I'm seeing a lot of like content creators and things like that. So hopefully my algorithm will kind of curate to, I want to see some of that stuff sometimes, but I want to also see like just regular, you know, people doing, you know, posting stuff.
So I think they have hashtags and stuff that are active, but unless they had an update, so maybe that'll help. And just like a general like explore page, and like you could filter your experience, because algorithms really mess us up as content creators and things like that. Because I used to, like, my reels used to get like easy views. Now it's like I don't know, shadow ban, like what happens? It's so weird, but we'll see.
For sure. So that's how we can find you. You said Facebook, Instagram. We got the women's retreat coming up.
Yes,
so
I'm gonna send you the link.
Okay, I'm gonna put that in the description. So you have, you said 3 or 5 spots left.
I have. I'm trying to think, because I don't really want to count the spot into the deposit is paid. So
gotcha, right? Of course.
With two people, I'm like, yeah, we gonna come, but you gotta pay the deposit.
Gotta pay that deposit, and if you don't, and you pocket too,
you gotta get in there. So
yeah. Okay, so we'll put that link in the description. And definitely whenever I'm promoting the episode, I'll make sure that we, you know, post that as well. Yeah. You know, y'all listen, get on this retreat, because. And I'm pretty sure you'll have more coming up. If you can't make this one, I'm pretty sure you'll have more. So that's what's up. You guys can follow me at Tierra Laray. I took all the hashtags out. I mean, the underscores, I say hashtags, all the underscores out of my names on social media, because it's easier for you to find me that way. Tierra Laray on all social media. Follow the podcast page at Rated M, because we MF grown. And again, sending your dating horror stories. And again, Klee, I appreciate you coming on this episode. It was a great conversation. We will talk.
Get me up my show.
Yes, we got to talk again for sure. Thank you to all of the people that have listened. Make sure you check out the recap episode. I think that episode is really going to make you like, oh, I need to tune into this girl, because she's pretty funny. She be dropping some gems. But I appreciate all of those who do listen. And I'm only going up from here. You know, I'm more guests to come, because, you know, I've been saying, Klee, that I'm tired of doing these solo episodes. I hate doing the solo episodes. I just really do what I know. I got to get the content out. So I appreciate having the guests. And we talked about that. I remember I had made a post about looking for a co-host. And he was like, you got to just have your guests figure it out like that.
I'm going to jump in with a solution. Sometimes when nobody asks for one, but that's just
I love that. And you have to surround yourself with people like that are solution. But like, Because my thing is, I'm a transparent person. So when I talk to people, I do tell them, like, hey, this is what I got going on. And I love whenever I'm talking to somebody and they can come with a solution. I'm like, ooh, listen, come on, man. I appreciate that. So, yeah, so I appreciate, you know, you was like, hey, just have your guests come on and maybe figure it out that way. You know, you might find your co-host that way. And that's a great idea. So I'm going to continue to have the guests come on. That's a beautiful thing, because I love to be able to just kind of bounce these ideas off of other people, just have the conversations with other people and not just having them with myself. But more guests to come, y'all. And y'all stay tuned for all the great things that Rated M has going on. And I will talk to y'all next week. Bye. Bye.